Do you know what to do in the event of a nuclear war? Do you know that the evacuation plan, according to civil defense for the city of Somerville, involves a total evacuation of this city and everyone from here going up to Kennebunk, Maine? Some people feel that it makes sense to put energy into what the world would be like after a nuclear war. Other people feel like we don't need to worry about what life's going to be like after a nuclear war, because the devastation and the destruction is going to be so total that life is really unthinkable at that point. Those people feel that we should put our efforts into preventing war rather than thinking about what life would be like after a nuclear war happened. This is Dead Air Live. My name is John Jaffe, and tonight we're going to look at both sides of that issue. I'd like to introduce to you at home the three guests now who are with me here in the studio. First, going around clockwise, David Meyer. David is a member of People Against Annihilation. He is a Somerville resident, and he is involved in the Speak Out Planning Committee. Welcome, David.
Hello.
Next, Regina Eddy. Regina is a staff member on the Ad Hoc Committee for the Safe Boston Harbor. Regina is also a Somerville resident and is a member of Mobilization for Survival. Hi. And last, John Halperin. John is also a Somerville resident, 3 for 3, and is involved in a number of groups, including work with a group called Priorities, a group called the Nuclear Weapons Discussion Project, People Against Annihilation, and Business Alert. And John wanted it known that although he's a member of these various organizations, he's expressing his own opinions here tonight. So let me welcome all of you to the show. In terms of getting into this, I know in addition to on the national level where there's been the nuclear freeze in the House of Representatives, the bishops have had a conference and struggling with what to do. One of the things that's focused attention on the local level in what's going on in this area is a civil defense plan that's gotten a lot of publicity lately. And in fact, there was a public hearing recently. I'm wondering if one of you could comment a little bit about how that got organized and what went on in that.
Well, David? I'd start by saying the reason that we have crisis relocation plans is because nobody knows what they're about. And it's something that the government really doesn't want to make very public because, as you'll see when we see the videotape, it's really a ridiculous idea. The idea that of moving the entire population of Somerville up to Kennebunk, Maine is not going to happen. So this information isn't particularly accessible. People in People Against Annihilation decided to make it accessible following in the footsteps of many other towns which have formally rejected their crisis relocation plans. Now, after we did some research and found out what our plan was, and found out that Mayor Brune hadn't taken a strong stand on the issue, we said, well, Mayor Brune, this is what the situation is. And he said, yeah, you're right, this is ridiculous, and decided to call a public hearing to discuss the plan.
But it was at the initiative of People Against Annihilation.
And that's the way the disarmament movement's been throughout the world. It's people at the grassroots who are making things happen. Public officials will respond to that, but they won't respond unless people off the street, everyday people, put it on the political agenda. And that's one of the functions that groups like People Against Annihilation has.
So the purpose of the hearing was what?
The purpose of the hearing was to inform the public about what our elected officials are supposedly planning for us. And to, in the best traditions of American democracy, getting people in the street corners, people from all walks of life involved in making decisions that affect their lives. And Somerville elected officials were very, very responsive to the demands of the people. Mayor Brune, for example, provided very responsible, very foresighted, very sane leadership on this issue after it was brought to his attention.
Okay, well, I'm sure that you'll all have a lot to say about the whole issue of whether it makes sense, in fact, to have a civil defense plan or not, but maybe the place to start is to lay out exactly what the civil defense plan is for Somerville. So, for people at home, we're going to see a videotape which is going to talk about the civil defense plan and really begin to address the issue of how much destruction would result from a nuclear war. And now, let's see the tape.
Dr. Jim Muller, a cardiologist at Harvard Medical School, is founder of the International Physicians for Prevention of Nuclear War. group of 100 medical doctors in 12 countries working to educate their people and their governments on the medical effects of nuclear war. Dr. Mueller described the devastation Boston would suffer if a 1 megaton nuclear bomb fell on the city. The blast from that bomb, 80 times larger than the Hiroshima bomb, would create a crater a quarter of a mile wide and 300 feet deep.
All the buildings in Boston and Cambridge, in Chelsea, would be destroyed. The Prudential, the John Hancock, the Trinity Church, they would be leveled. People, there would be 100% fatalities within this area. In an area farther out to 6 miles, there would be 90% casualties in this area. This would include Revere, Malden, Medford, Watertown, Brookline. 50% of the people would be killed immediately. 40% would be wounded. Their wounds would be burns, they'd be cuts from flying glass, they'd be thrown against buildings with 100, 200 mile an hour winds. They would be deafened by the blast from on their eardrums. In an area farther out to 10 miles from the center, there would be 50% injuries within here. A person standing out on 128 in the open when this bomb was exploded over the center of Boston would get third degree burns on exposed areas. That would be the effect of a single 1 megaton bomb on the city of Boston. It's more likely that we'd be hit by 10.
I do think, however, that nuclear war is survivable, and that if we make proper preparations, that we can survive as a nation. We're trying to relocate people away from the areas where they would be killed by the direct effects of blast from a nuclear weapon or from high radiation effects to areas of the state and the rest of New England where they would be safer. And by doing this, we could increase our survivability from an all-out attack, which would be in the area of 50%, to close to 90% if we could relocate people out of these areas of the direct effects.
The evacuation plan for Somerville calls for residents with automobiles to drive north up Route 93. The 24,000 residents of Somerville without cars will be instructed to assemble in the public schools to wait for Recreation Department vehicles and MBTA buses. Passing the exit for Route 128, merge with traffic from 11 other Boston area communities and continue north to Route 495. Citizens are advised to bring adequate clothing, blankets, and 3 days' supply of water and non-perishable food. Follow Route 495 onto 95 through New Hampshire and take exit 3 off the main turnpike, picking up Route 35 into Kennebunk.
Do you know where this started? Where did this originate anyway? Do you have any idea on that?
Washington.
Where?
I'm sure, you know, everything comes down from a national level to states. Pretty much, you know, federal and national policy that, you know, dictates down to the different states as to what they're going to do. And then I don't know who, as far as, made the decision that Somerville comes to Kennebunk. Whether that was done on a comparative basis out of Washington or whether it was done on a regional type of basis or what. It's a good question.
Yeah.
You have a fallout shelter here?
I would say there are probably two or three selected buildings in the town. I wouldn't say we now have a capacity to even take care of the citizens of Kennebunk, let alone Somerville.
Well, that leads to the question where the storekeeper downtown read in the paper where they had selected his cellar for a shelter for 100 and some people. And he says if you can get 20 in it, you've done extremely well.
Well, I think, you know, one of the things that they mentioned, you know, in this evacuation type thing is that they feel that we are going to have a head start from the standpoint of knowing it's, you know, it's a very critical, you know, political situation. And, you know, I guess the question is who actually pulls the switch as far as saying, hey, start the evacuation, and who pulls the switch as far as, you know, sending the bombs.
Welcome back. And before we get into discussing the tape that you've just seen, two things. First, I would strongly encourage people to give us a call here tonight. And we want to know what you think about whether a civil defense plan makes sense or not. If you think it does, or if you think it doesn't, what should we do about the prospect of a nuclear war? So give us a call at 628-6750. Second thing is that we hope to have on, in addition to the three guests who are here in the studio, someone from either the Civil Defense Office in the first place, and several people were willing to be on, but unfortunately, in terms of their schedules, were unable to actually be here tonight. We had also been interested in having on a survivalist, and were unable, despite our efforts, to have someone be on the show. So do give us a call. Well, I'm sure you all have a lot of thoughts having seen that. It seems to me one issue was really what would the destruction be that would result from a nuclear attack?
One thing that I think is interesting is that we saw the description of what would happen in Boston, and then Doug Forbes, representing Civil Defense, added that he still believes that nuclear war is survivable. And one thing that's interesting to try and look at is the facts, in some senses, versus what Doug Forbes believes. One thing that sort of struck me was that if you take the nuclear destructive power of the world in bombs and missiles and figure out how many Hiroshima-sized bombs that is, and then if you look in the back of a U.S. road atlas and count the number of cities, Somerville being one of them, and then do the math, you find out that we have 47 Hiroshima-sized bombs per city. So if Boston is hit,
you're talking about what is in the Soviet arsenal.
Total world.
Uh-huh. Okay.
If you then want to cut that in half and take ours or even a third, you then got maybe 10 Hiroshima-sized bombs for Boston, Somerville, Dorchester, etc. And nuclear war is survivable?
Mm-hmm.
Dubious.
I would agree with the same objection that, first of all, if there is any, if any bomb is, you know, dropped on the city of Boston surrounding Somerville, that there is no guarantee that Route 93 itself is not going to be destroyed. And I know myself just getting from Davis Square to Union Square can take a half an hour with everybody else trying to do the same thing and piling up on 93 with any, damage done to 93 itself, you might as well just turn the key in the ignition off and get out of the car and just sit and enjoy the last few minutes that you're going to have. That, you know, it just seems so unforeseeable that I really take objection to Forbes saying that he thinks a nuclear war is survivable.
You know, I'd want to add something else to that, too. I agree with you, of course. The talk about surviving a nuclear war is ridiculous, but I think it takes, it moves debate from another important issue, which is how much money do we want to be spending on nuclear weapons now? Even if a nuclear bomb is not dropped in the next 10 years, the effects of the nuclear arms race are very significant for the city of Somerville. All we have to do is look at the unemployment rate. We know how much money is being spent on weapons in this country. This is having a severe effect on our economy. And crisis relocation plans are one way of moving the scope of the debate away from that. Saying
but the other side of that, isn't the other side of that, that according to figures provided by Doug Forbes in Civil Defense, that it was only $210,000 that was provided to, on a state level in Massachusetts, to develop the plan that we saw. So you're not talking about a tremendous amount of money.
Doug Forbes tell you about the $232 billion spent by the United States government on defense? Did that come up in your conversation? The fact
well,
that...
Well, I mean, I think... I understand what you're saying, but in some ways they're different issues. To the extent that if you think that nuclear war is survivable in some way, not to deny the impact of a nuclear buildup on the economy. In fact, he had some interesting statistics on that, of saying that, I'm trying to remember precisely, I hope I'm quoting him accurately while he's not here. He said that with adequate notice, the casualty rate in the Boston area would be only 20%. And in an unannounced attack, the casualty rate would be 50%.
Can I respond to that?
Sure.
And in part, I disagree a little bit with David on the economics, because I think there's a bigger question in some sense, which is the notion that Civil Defense is operating from a set of assumptions like with adequate notice, and then you can make some calculations. And those assumptions are totally divorced from reality.
Adequate notice sounds nice in a plan. What's adequate notice? How do you get adequate notice? It takes 20 minutes for a Soviet ICBM to get here. The Somerville plan says that in a period of heightened international tension, we'd be forewarned. That also sounds reasonable, but what's heightened international tension? Mm-hmm. Poland? Afghanistan? The Falklands?
One of the scenarios, well, no one can deny that there are a lot of tensions internationally
when,
that you can point to.
Evacuate.
Well, one scenario is that the United States discovers that the Russians are evacuating their cities in anticipation of a planned nuclear attack.
Okay.
And therefore begin in a similar vein, in a planned way, based on the civil defense plan that we saw, to do the same, to minimize the amount of casualties.
So that then we become pawns in the strategic game. The citizens do, as opposed to having just weapons and missiles, the people now are thrown into that same pot. Is that right? That seems to me that that's what he's saying.
I think he's saying that if we know that the Russians are evacuating their cities and it looks like it's in anticipation of an attack, there's something that we can do in a preventative way to cut down on the amount of casualties.
You know, in Somerville we have history and we know more about crisis relocation plans than most other cities. Because 3 years ago, we had a chemical spill. In fact, we tried to plan this crisis relocation hearing on the same day on the anniversary of that chemical spill. And over the course of a day, we were able to evacuate 14,000 people from affected areas. It took a whole day. It took the combined resources of the entire metropolitan district, right? 14,000 people. And where did they have to be evacuated to? Not Kennebunk, Maine. You know, West Somerville, perhaps? That would be okay.
And hey, at the time, it was only the residents of Somerville. I think of any person who commutes regularly from Somerville to any part of the metropolitan area in Boston, that with Boston trying to evacuate, Somerville, Melrose, people in Malden, people in Cambridge, I don't imagine 93 is going to be anything other than a parking lot. If it's in an intact parking lot, then we're even perhaps a little bit luckier, but I have no confidence at all. So I think as a resident of Somerville, I take strong objection to what Forbes is saying. I think it's fallacious. I think it is misleading the people to think there is any viable defense plan, civil defense plan, that can be developed for the city of Boston, despite people working in City Hall in good conscience trying to develop one. I think the whole issue of nuclear war opens an arena that is totally unpredictable, and that the purpose as citizens in Somerville, like PAA, questioning the defense plan is pushing people to say, be honest and upfront about our helplessness. Mm-hmm. And people in Cambridge came forth and did that, and so did people in Arlington. And the city council actually in Cambridge took the initiative to publish a civil defense plan that said, in our best opinion, we've reviewed this, and in all honesty, the only defense we have is to fight the existence of nuclear weapons. Mm-hmm. I think that's the most upfront statement that could be made.
Parenthetically, we in Somerville are now working on putting together a similar booklet. Mm-hmm.
As was done in
Cambridge, Arlington, Amherst.
Let me just throw out one more statistic and respond to that, because I think this gets back to, you know, is there a world after, you know, is there a viable alternative in terms of considering what life would be like after a nuclear attack? And again, according to the Civil Defense Office, it's one of their scenarios was in terms of the level of destruction that outside of a 5-mile radius, you might not have more than, say, 70 mile an hour winds, which would presumably be, that's gale force, but presumably would be fairly readily survivable. Wondering if any of you have any sense of different figures in terms of the extent of destruction that would take place?
Yeah, it's again the distinction of playing something out on paper, which is I think what's happened there, and then looking beneath that to see what the assumptions are and how you can vary that. I don't know what size bomb that calculates. It also assumes that there's probably only one in the whole area, not multiple ones, which then changes the scenario. But for example, and this is from a little government spin-around computer that you can calculate this morbid kind of information, but if a 2-megaton bomb landed at City Hall, Highland Avenue, leaving everything else aside, you would have a fireball, a mass of flames, thousands of degrees centigrade, spreading a mile, 0.2, in every direction. Okay. That alone incinerates a large part of what we know as Somerville. extends into Charlestown, it extends up into Medford and south into Cambridge. So we can play out the scenarios, but the level of destruction, if you look at it in reality and the number of bombs and the power of them, is beyond.
Most of Somerville made of too. It's wood. It's incredibly flammable. We read about that in the paper every day too.
Right. Yeah, but it's hard to imagine a furnace a mile with a mile radius. Mm-hmm. But that's what you'd get.
Maybe we can come back to this, and we have another videotape which sort of looks at both sides of this issue again, and in terms of the amount of destruction that might actually take place. So let's now take a look at our next videotape.
Well, Somerville, they want us all to go to Kennebunk, Maine, up 93.
Yeah, okay. Sure.
Do you think it'll work?
The 4th of July weekend, or?
Whenever.
Whenever. I don't think it'll work unless they call me a couple days ahead of time.
Give you advance notice?
Yeah, so I can beat the traffic.
What about people that don't have cars? Or do you have a car?
Oh, I have a car, yeah.
What about people that don't have cars? How do you think they'll make it?
I don't think they'll make it too well, do you?
No.
They could thumb, of course, and I suppose that everybody else would pick them up.
Right, if they hitchhike, right.
Of course.
Somerville, they want us to go to Kennebunk, Maine, up 93.
They're out of their mind. Have you ever been up Route 1 to make it to Kennebunk?
No.
Never happened. You can go up there on rush hour, and it's jammed. And if a nuclear fallout ever happened with dead people, we might make it to Portsmouth, New Hampshire. That's as far as we get.
What have you heard about it?
Yeah. Yeah.
What do you think about it?
I'm not going to be able to do it. It's going to be too many cars. Mm-hmm. There's people trying to get out.
What about people that don't even have cars?
They're not going to make it. They should just stop it now.
Well, being an ex-civil defense secretary, I don't know. It should work, but I doubt it.
Why do you doubt it?
Because there'll be such a mass of people. And I don't think it's quite planned.
What would the elderly do if they had to get out of Somerville?
Well, they're supposed to wait for the recreation department vehicles to come and pick them up, or otherwise the T. You think that's a good plan?
Oh, good grief. It might be too late then. Get one good big blow here.
By the time the cars bumper to bumper, you'd never make it. You're better off right where you are.
What do you think the city should do in a case of a nuclear war then?
Well, I what do I think what they should do? I don't think there's anything they can really do. I really don't in a nuclear war.
What do you think of this plan that 77,000 people from Somerville are going to come up here and take up residence here in case of a nuclear emergency or disaster?
It's a little ludicrous, I think, to think that a city of 77,000 can come to our town of 7,700 and have the facilities to accommodate such an onslaught. It sounds probably goes hand in hand with most of the government thoughts in this area, I would say. I don't know why they'd want to come up here to start with. We have Kittery Navy Yard on one side of us, and we have the new Bath shipyard on the other side of us. And I really don't think that the people dropping the bombs care that they're that close to the target, and I really can't see any reason why those people down there would like to come up. Another thing I'm just wondering, I don't believe the enemy would ever give us a week's notice that they were going to bomb so we could be prepared for it.
I worry about you coming down a highway. How many other towns, cities, Massachusetts, New Hampshire, are coming to the town of Kennebunk? Beyond the town of Kennebunk, some other town in Maine, who's going to get on the highway first? And if I'm on there and I'm going down a road, I'm not going to let you in if you've got a red light, if you go through the toll booth. I'm not letting you in. I'm going down the road. I'm not going to stop and pick up anybody who's crying on the side of the road and says, help me. Everybody's going to say, survival of the fittest. And that's number one, me.
I think I'd want to get a gun. I really would. I just can't imagine people just all of a sudden coming in, being plopped down, and not all sorts of vandalism. And it just seems incredible to me.
I understand that you know someone in Kennebunk, Maine.
Yeah, the police commissioner's my father's best friend, and he thinks it's a really good idea either.
I have 10 full-time men. It would be impossible for us to handle. We're expecting now a crowd maybe 25, maybe even 30,000 people this summer here. I have 10 full-time people and 14 part-timers. No way could we handle traffic problems. We're stretched to the limit just with the summer crowd that comes to tourists.
My first thoughts about rejecting this plan when I found out that the mayor was the last one to leave the city. So right then and there, I knew that this plan had much merit. We saw the difficulties in evacuating 14,000 people during the chemical spill from one end of the city to the other with all sorts of help. Those able to make it to Kennebunk, Maine escaped the beast and fire of the weapons, dozens of times more powerful than a Hiroshima bomb, would not escape. The subsequent radiation, lack of clean water, food, and shelter, brought to hundreds of miles away, depending upon wind patterns, the nature of the bomb and other factors, radiation would kill thousands. We cannot be dishonest with the citizens in our community about the inability to provide public safety in a nuclear war.
I think that the thing that bothers me the most of this, by doing all of this, what I call stupidity, we're lending people a false sense of security that we can protect them. I think that's very, very bad to try to do the American people. There is no way we can protect those people. You may protect one town, one city, but I'm sure if I were going to bomb some other nation, I wouldn't wait for a nice warm day in the summertime. I would not wait till you were prepared for me. I picked the worst day of the year, snow-wise, when the roads are blocked anyway, so you're not going anyplace. I would absolutely, of course it's got to be in secrecy, I would bomb enough cities so that you're all stopped. How are you going to get out of here? I really think it's a sham and it's a hoax to perpetrate on the American people. I really do.
Again, let me invite you to please give us a call here. What do you think about the civil defense plan for Somerville? 628-6750. Well, it's pretty easy in some ways to poke holes in. Well, you can imagine what you were talking about, Regina, before, about will parts of the highway be left on 93? What's it like in normal rush hour traffic and all of that? But isn't it, nonetheless, having said all that, government's responsibility, because there may be survivors, to try to plan for that?
I would rather say that the government should ensure for the survival of all of us, and that in order to do that, they should just consider seriously a nuclear weapons freeze and then total dismantling and reduction of all nuclear weapons. I don't think that there is any better way to protect the citizens of the United States. Yeah. That would be my opinion.
It definitely is the government's responsibility to protect, you know, the citizens. This plan, some parts of civil defense may do that. The chemical spill was an example of some good uses of civil defense. Crisis relocation planning and nuclear protection in nuclear war is a hoax. We heard the people up in Kennebunk saying they're not ready for us, they can't handle it. We have written in the government document for Somerville that plans are being made in Kennebunk to handle things properly. That's not protecting the citizens, that's lying to them.
This may not change your position, but I understand from what Doug Forbes has indicated to people in our group, the Somerville Producers Group, that they are rethinking Kennebunk and are thinking of Biddeford, which I guess is a community, an industrial community with large, solid factory buildings.
I feel sorry for Biddeford.
I think there's another reason for that. George Bush has a summer home in Kennebunk, and I'd written to him asking him to make up the guest room for me in the event of a nuclear holocaust. And I guess that was the response, right? Moving it to Biddeford instead. I want to talk just a second about government responsibility. I think you're right, it is the government's responsibility to protect its citizenry. But what we've seen thus far is that the government's only taken responsibility when the citizens have said, look out for us. And what's happened in Somerville is the citizen said, the government's not looking out for us. Mayor Bruin said, the federal government plan, the state plan, is not looking out for the best interests of Somerville. We need this money to buy filter masks for our firemen. Okay? Mm-hmm. And the government will take responsibility for its citizens only when the citizens say, we need you to take responsibility for us. When we say, and this is the way to do it.
But still, isn't it possible that some people may survive a war?
Survive for what? Survive to what?
Yeah, it is. And I think, again, that they've made the calculations that X number of million will die and X number will survive. And some probably will, somewhere. It's a question of sort of defining what you mean. Survive without any food, without any social structure, without any transportation, without any communications. Technically, life for some people biologically might go on. It may not go on for very long, and whether that's really survival is debatable at best, I think.
Yeah, there's also actually no documentation on to what extent food and water supplies are going to be totally contaminated irreparably, and also that those few who do make it to Kennebunk get there only to discover that there's a second wave in the nuclear attack and that the naval base, as the resident of Kennebunk mentioned, is also under attack.
A lot's been made also of the fact that people who survive are going to survive with cancers, are going to survive with third degree burns, and without doctors who are concentrated in all the target areas to do any of the treatment for them.
Mm-hmm. Well, civil defense does acknowledge food is a problem, and what they say is that actually in the country as a whole, there's approximately 500 days of food supplies already in existence. Although they do say that obviously that getting that food to a particular place where some people might go to try to protect themselves is an issue. I think they're aware of that.
And John, I'm afraid what they're not calculating or even revealing in that kind of a statement is that food supplies will be contaminated, that everything will be irradiated, that for example, there are still people who had suffered from the bombing of Nagasaki and Hiroshima who are suffering those illnesses today. There were cell damages, some of it has been genetic, and that people are still being reminded of a Holocaust that occurred, 35, 37 years ago. There is no guarantee that that people, ourselves, those who survive and walk out to the streets then to try and in search of some of that food, themselves will not be harmed by the radiation, and to when they go to drink the water, that's not going to also be ingested. There really, any kind of a plan that talks about guarantees or survival, I think absolutely has to be countered.
Yeah, just a quick comment. Go ahead, John. Yeah.
You're right, that there is the natural instinct to protect people. Part of the problem is that that's changed with nuclear weapons. You can't play that game anymore. The bigger the gun doesn't mean that you're better protected anymore. The whole scenario is different.
In fact, we do have another videotape now which gets to if we begin to assume, as all of you are saying very clearly, that nuclear war is not really survivable and we need to put our energies into finding alternatives in a preventative way, what does that mean? And that's certainly what we'll want to talk about when we come back. But before that, we have a videotape, and if we're ready, let's take a look at the videotape now.
If you had to ask the mayor to do something about this, what would you ask him to do?
Well, I'd ask him to look into it and write letters to different congressmen and, try to get across to these people in other countries to all get together and see what they could do about it, because somebody's going to get it. Either they will or we will.
What will you do about it?
Well, I'll tell you. If it hits me, I just hope I go fast. That's all I can say. I wouldn't even want to live. No, I wouldn't want to live, because I don't think it'd be worthwhile to live once that thing got here.
Is there anything you think that citizens like ourselves can do to stop nuclear war?
Yeah, demonstrate. Let them know. Just get out there and by sheer numbers. Let the political people, our government officials, let the president know. I mean, we don't want nuclear war. It's evident. Everybody said so. I mean, you don't have to have too much gray matter to know. It's just ridiculous suicide. Yeah.
It seems strange that rather than attempting to do what we think is the most common sense thing to do, and that is plan not to have a nuclear war.
The idea that crisis relocation planning, or the new name for comprehensive emergency management, can provide real safety, public
irresponsible, it seems to me, to fool the citizens of this city or any community.
Our state civil defense should be sending a message to the federal government, telling them that this plan is ridiculous and that it's impossible for us to win a nuclear war. Who wants to win one anyway? And that we refuse to implement this plan. I think the city of Sullivan should refuse to implement this plan in terms of a nuclear disaster, at least. And unfortunately, the civil defense department depends on the federal government for its funds, or for really anonymous funds. And I think that may not be possible to get the state government to do it, but I certainly think it's possible for the city government to say that this is a ridiculous plan, we refuse to implement it, and send that message loud and clear to our officials in Washington, so that at least this community will say that there is something more important than trying to win the nuclear war, and that's to stop the nuclear war.
Time, energy, and money should be put into world programs. There is no reliable protection against nuclear attack.
I would like to propose several actions. One, that the Board of Aldermen, in addition to myself, go on record as rejecting, as unworkable, the concept of the FEMA Crisis Relocation Plan for providing safety from nuclear war. That we convey these sentiments to our members of Congress, to the government, and to the state civil defense. Two, I would urge that our state civil defense department focus the money and resources delegated to them for the crisis relocation plan on public safety for such disasters as spills, toxic substance, hazardous waste, blizzards, floods, and etc. This is consistent with the dual use provision of the Federal Civil Defense Act of 1950 as amended. In the wake of the Sullivan chemical spill, I see a further need for planning and coordinating to deal with civil disasters. Three, I propose that the city distribute an educational brochure on the effects of nuclear weapons and the speed with which a disaster could occur. This has been done in Cambridge, Newton, and Amherst. Private funds for materials could be raised for this venture, and the city could be responsible for the printing through their Sullivan Trade School. And four, I would urge our members of Congress to make it a priority to seek a United States USSR verifiable, not agreement to reduce nuclear weapons stockpile and not to fund any new nuclear weapons. I believe this is the route to achieving a strong defense, which is a safe defense.
I personally cannot see that this is something that we should even be thinking about. I would much rather concentrate all of our activities, all of our time, our money, into prevention.
To follow up on what the last person interviewed said, that she saying that it's not worth it to put our time into the civil defense and thinking about Kennebunkport. People need to put their energies into prevention, which is certainly in one way or another what each of you has been saying. But what does that mean in concrete terms? How can people have an impact? In what ways?
I think it's important for people from People Against Annihilation, which both of the two other guests are, is to feel proud of the fact that just by pushing a little bit in the city of Somerville, the people actually got the support from the mayor's office in terms of thinking about the issue of crisis relocation and realizing the plan was ineffective. And the people need to realize that they can have impact on the community level.
The crisis relocation plan hearing was a real triumph for the people of Somerville. And we're lucky that we have responsible leadership that was responsive to these issues. Unfortunately, decisions about the nuclear arms race are not made by Mayor Broome. And that means that it's a long process that has to go on. And for starters, you have to educate yourself. You can't depend on President Reagan's speeches twice a month to keep you informed of all the latest developments in nuclear war. And Somerville Library is a good place to start to do that. They already have an extensive bibliography on nuclear weapon issues. Then there's People Against Annihilation, one group in Somerville. I'm going to read off two contact numbers, 628-1516, People Against Annihilation, 628-0049, People Against Annihilation. One more group, the Somerville Speak Out Group, which is going to be planning fair budget hearings for the fall and needs a lot of work, good opportunity to do organizing, meets the second and fourth Monday of every month in the old firehouse on Broadway. I think it's 165 Broadway. It looks like a firehouse, so you'll recognize it even if you can't see the number.
John,
I'll just add to that that it's, in some sense, easy for us to sit up here and preach that people should get involved, but that is how things happen. Over the last 2 years, it wasn't anybody with special knowledge or fancy degrees that started changing the course of the way we make arms policy. It was people, common citizens who were concerned about the direction the country was going. And if you think about what each individual's skills are and are concerned and begin slowly applying them to arms control by calling a group, by talking to friends, by reading, by beginning to think seriously about the issue, that ultimately does have an effect. That's why we're all discussing this today and weren't 2 years ago.
I guess that's always the thing that I keep coming back to in some ways, is that this is an international, an issue on an international, global scope. And I think it's often hard as an individual in a local level, one person in a particular community and not with a lot of capital or strong special interest group behind, can you really have an impact?
All over the world, it's regular people who thought that for a long time and stopped thinking that, who are having an impact. As soon as you get onto the street and talk to your neighbor and find out they're thinking the same things as you are, then you're not alone anymore.
Let's start with a really concrete point. At this stage in the development, Tip O'Neill is somewhat hesitant and has let people know in terms of the decision about the MX missile. For all of us who live in Somerville, Tip O'Neill is our representative. And if people have a pen, they should copy down the number 223-2784. That's Tip's office here in Boston. People should call and say, under no circumstances should he support funding of the MX missile. Take about 2 or 3 minutes of your time. Very important. The number again is 223-2784.
Just to follow up and emphasize again that for years and still today, common citizens like all of us have been told that we can't make a difference, that the decision has to get made in Washington by people who work in the Defense Department and have great specialty. They haven't done such a wonderful job. They really haven't. And that makes it all the more important that we keep working and that new people join the effort at serious arms control and send a message. It's slow work. Things do change, though.
And the first response we get is always a symbolic one. President Reagan or any other leader will say, yes, we want peace too. And that's how come it's important that we educate ourselves. Now, for example, Tip O'Neill, as Regina said, has supported the freeze since it became imperative for him to do so, but he wants the MX. Now, there's other issues, local issues, about Boston and the Boston Harbor. Regina.
Right, there's a plan submitted by Dukakis and supported by Kennedy, O'Neill, and other free supporters that is in favor of having nuclear weapons come with a battleship fleet to the Boston Harbor. Very important for people to show up in Waterfront Park on June 25th to say we do not want nuclear weapons in the Boston Harbor. In fact, we do not want nuclear weapons in any harbor in the United States. So there are local things going on that it's very important for people to lend their support to.
Peace wins.
Piece of that puzzle, which these kinds of people like us are often criticized for, and which is an argument for bringing the Navy to Boston, is that it generates jobs. It's good for the economy. The economy is bad. We need that. That's another one of those myths or assumptions that common citizens have begun challenging. There are lots of studies. There's, I'm sure, material in the Somerville Library that addresses that question. It's not so clear that military spending is, as often assumed, by definition, good for the economy. You can trot out a list of economic arguments, which I I'm not qualified and don't want to do here. Mm-hmm. But that's another assumption, like that civil defense is good, that needs to be challenged.
Okay, on that note, we're running out of time. There is much more to be said, but I think it's also clear that there are a lot of ways that people can be involved. And certainly all of your experiences, you can have a real impact. 10 seconds.
June 11th, June 12th. June 11th, you'll see people with cans asking for money in commemoration of June 12th last year, the biggest demonstration ever in American history in New York City, a million people. June 12th, people joining hands across Somerville. Peace links. And this is also in commemoration of June 12th.
Okay, let me thank all of you. David Meyer, thank you. Regina Eddy, John Halperin. And to our audience, we're going to take a brief break and come back for the last part of the show, which is going to be on a different issue than the nuclear freeze. It's going to be on possible budget cuts at the Somerville Hospital. So there's going to be a song, there's a videotape, and then in a couple minutes we'll be back live in the studio. So stay with us.
This has a wonderful sing-along part. I'll let you know when it comes in. This is called Greenfield. They're delivering the mail to Greenfield, 'cause Boston has gone bust. They're delivering the mail to Greenfield, as deliver it they must. The mail will reach our new address, the first bomb shelter on the left. The rain and snow and gloom of night and now, through nuclear dust. When hell has come to play on Earth and radiation thrives, it's really, no, it's not a holocaust. It's just an interruption in our lives. So take along your credit card, your shovel and some clothes. We'll preserve our future, even if our money glows. Stop down on your knees, say pretty please, we love to go. A nice long holiday would be okay, can't wait to go. Off we go into the wide blue yonder. Well, the sing-along part goes like that. It's drop down on your knees, say pretty please, we'd love to go. A nice long holiday would be okay, can't wait to go. Give it a try. So drop down on your knees, say pretty please, say pretty please, we'd love to go, we'd love to go. We'll stop and have a picnic on our arrival there. We'll smile and nod through gas masks.
I'm here now with a new guest in the studio with me, and her name is Carol Souza. Carol is a representative of, and correct me if I don't get this right, okay, the Somerville Community and Hospital Employees Coalition for Quality Health Care. And I know that your group was interested in being on our show because you're real concerned about the possible budget cuts that are coming along for Somerville Hospital. So I wonder if you could say a little about your concerns about this, Carol.
Sure. Well, about 4 or 5 weeks ago, Norman Girard, the president of Somerville Hospital, had a meeting with employees where he laid out that the hospital was going to reduce its operating cost $1.2 million this fiscal year, that's before October 1st, and $1.6 million for the next fiscal year. He talked about most of that reduction in costs coming in layoffs and reduction in benefits for employees and services. So a group of concerned employees got together with a group called Common Health, and this organization, Common Health, have done a lot of work around the new Massachusetts legislation, Chapter 372, which is one of the reasons the hospital is saying they need to make these cuts in costs. We got together with them, and asked Mr. Girard if he would consider meeting with a group of employees and community people around these budget cuts and what was going to happen at the hospital and the services. He refused. At that point, we decided to hold a community educational evening, which is going to be at Lincoln Park School on May 22nd, Sunday night, 7 to 9, where we are going to make a presentation on this legislation, the particulars of Somerville Hospital, and draw up some kind of resolution and proposal to Mr. Girard that we want to be involved in the budgeting and in whatever cuts happen at the hospital, the community people and employees at the hospital.
You mentioned like the cuts would be somewhere between 1.2 and 1.5 million. What, do you have any idea what percentage of, just to make some sense of those figures, what percentage of the total budget that is?
It's 15 to 20%.
Uh-huh, that much.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what the rationale is for it?
Well, the reason...
That's a major cut.
Really. The reason given to us was the primarily Chapter 372 legislation and the general inflation factor and the reduction in reimbursement through Medicaid and Medicare costs. The research that we have done on the financial situation in the hospital points out that these kind of cuts do not have to come from layoffs or a reduction in benefits, and that if he will open the books to the community and allow us to be part of the process, we can guarantee that there's another way to do it and the quality of health care won't be affected.
You, I don't know if you noticed when you said something, Chapter 372?
Mm-hmm.
What's that?
It's new cost-containing legislation that was passed last year.
Uh-huh.
It's Massachusetts hospital legislation. And what it was supposed to do is contain costs of hospitals. And the people from Common Health are going to give a presentation on that night. I don't have a lot of the particulars of the bill myself.
Hmm. Yeah. And your group is sponsoring the meeting on May 22nd? Or?
Yeah, we've done a lot of outreach into the community. We've got a lot of endorsements from community groups, and community people are involved in the coalition itself. And so this is the main thing that we're asking is to be allowed in the budgeting process, and we being employees and community people, and be allowed to take any part in any decisions that have to do with layoffs, cuts in services, or the quality of health care.
In the past, that's cuts of this extent, has that happened before?
No.
Or, I mean, one usually thinks more of the cost going into the running of a hospital. Hospitals expanding, I guess, is what I'm trying to say all the time.
Mm-hmm. No, this hasn't. Cuts of this size haven't ever been proposed, and we do not know why. In the work we've done on the financial situation of the hospital, we have not been able to find a reason why these kind of cuts have been proposed. No other community hospital has been making these kind of cuts. Have been claimed to be hit this hard by Chapter 372. That's why we want an in. We want to open the books. We want to find out what is the real reason that this kind of cuts are being proposed.
Actually, you anticipated my next question, which is one of the reasons or the rationales that's being given by the hospital administration is a statewide law. So one would assume that other hospitals would be similarly impacted by that.
It's hitting the teaching hospitals more than the community hospitals.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, it hasn't hit the other community hospitals to the extent that Mr. Girard is claiming that it's hitting Somerville Hospital. And the question on every employee's lips is why? You know, why this drastic action? Why are these cuts happening to us? And
is there some speculation, or is just like no one can figure that out?
Well, we don't have the most recent information, only they have that. And so that's why we need to get at the books, and we need for him to let us be involved in the budgeting.
So you feel as though you've approached the administration and tried to get some more feedback and sense of that?
Right, right.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, we've asked and been refused. There's an article last week in the community newspapers.
Oh, the Somerville News, which,
right.
As opposed to the Somerville Community News. Right,
the Somerville News,
okay.
Where the reporter was also refused an interview with Mr. Girard on these cuts. And so that newspaper is always delivered to the lobby of the hospital, and it was scooped up an hour after it was delivered there. So the administration has taken a position that they have let the employees be involved, and it's just not true. They haven't given us any information. They took the newspapers out of the lobby. They wouldn't allow us to put ad in the employee newspaper about Sunday night also. So that's why we're saying we need to have a say. We want to be involved.
Your hope is that who will come to this meeting?
Well, we're asking community people, concerned community people, uh-huh. and employees to come and have a say and let your voice be heard and let Norman Gerard know that you care about the quality of health care at the hospital. And that's, let's say again, Sunday night on the 22nd uh-huh. at Lincoln Park.
You've invited the I guess I'm not, your group is sponsoring the May 22nd hearing.
Mm-hmm.
And the administration has said they will be there or not, or you've extended
a hand
to them? Or
yeah, we had asked them if we could be involved in their board, in their process, and they have refused. So at this point, we went to the community. And it's open to anybody that wants to come, but they have not been friendly to us or, you know, have talked to us about it.
Is your group has just formed because of this issue, or there's a history to your group prior to this, or?
Well, some of the people involved, the concerned employees, were part of the Somerville Hospital Organizing Committee, which were a group of people involved in the union drive for the last 2 years at the hospital. And like I said, we joined up with Common Health and some community groups to form this coalition
uh-huh.
around the issue of quality health care.
Okay, I'm getting a cue that we have a phone call, so let's take that and see. Hello, you're on Dead Air Live. Did you have a comment or question?
Yeah, I was wondering if Carol, that you thought that the cuts might have anything to do with the union drive that has just gone on in Somerville Hospital.
Response to that?
It's an interesting thought. I don't think the cuts are happening because of the union drive or in response to it.
But that's... there was a union drive quite recently.
There was a union drive. It's been going on for the last 2 years. And I don't see the connection between the cuts and the union drive. And they had responded to the union drive, in fact, by increasing certain benefits to the employees. They began an employee newsletter and employee of the month type contest. And there were small gains that people got because of the union drive.
Mm-hmm. But this seems a really separate issue, more to do with the cost containment.
Yeah, I think it is.
We have just a little time left, so any last thoughts on this issue?
Well, just to encourage people to come, especially community people. It's not just an employee issue. And they're talking about cutting staff and laying off people, then the quality of health care is going to suffer, and it's going to mean services to the people of Somerville and the surrounding communities. So just we hope to see a lot of community people there as well and as employees.
Maybe you could say just one last time for people watching. Mm-hmm. Getting another call. Do we talk to my floor manager? Do we have time to take this and go over?
1 minute.
1 minute left in the whole show.
Yeah.
We'll be quick. You have a quick comment or question? We only got about 30 seconds.
This is... Susan, she has a senior action council behind her. We'll all be out there Sunday night.
Oh, great. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for listening. I'm one of them.
Thank you. So that's May 22nd at Lincoln Park Community School. Okay.
7 o'clock.
Let me thank you, Carol
thank
Susan,
you,
for being on Dead Air Live. Appreciate that. And for people who are watching, this show is going to be rebroadcast this coming Friday. That's May 20th at 7 o'clock. And a week from today, on May 24th at 9 o'clock. And I have a huge list of credits for people in the show, and I don't know if I have time to get them all in, but I will try. This show is brought to you by the Somerville Producers Group. And the people responsible for this show are, as producer, Charlie Tesh, also directing. As technical director, Nella Waters. Assisting in the technical directing, Linda Rubin. As audio, Claire Beach. Tapes, Marcia Green. Cameras, Greg West and Larry Yeager. Floor manager, Sandra Stephen. Lighting, Larry Yeager and Greg West. And myself, John Jaffe, is your host. So thanks to all of you for watching us. Please join us again 2 weeks from tonight on the next Data Live show. Thanks again, and so long.